chimpanzees live in equatorial Africa, which is the central part of Africa. They live in pretty diverse types of environments, much more diverse than the other great apes, everything from tropical rainforest to almost savanna environments.
They can live in large groups of 20 to 100 individuals, but it does depend on what area that they're in and how much territory and space that they have. Typically, there's a dominant male in a wild chimpanzee group.
And all male chimpanzees want to be the dominant male, so they're all vying for positions. And usually, the male who becomes the top male is physically strong. But more often, it's a male who's politically savvy, as we call it, who he has his constituents that he needs to keep happy, and that's basically what they do.
And a lot of times, the more dominant males also have to have the support of the high-ranking females within the group.
Chimpanzees live in what we call a multi-male, multi-female group, and that's just a fancy term. There'll be more than one male and more than one female making up a chimp group. And you'll often find that they're in family groups as well, so sisters will live together and they will help each other raise offspring.
Whereas the males actually spend a lot of time together. The males will groom each other, they do patrol the boundaries of their territories together. The females, however, tend to emigrate or leave their group when they become sexually mature.
Chimpanzees are omnivores. They're not vegetarians like a lot of people think. They eat mostly fruits, ripe fruits, but they also eat leaves and bark and different parts of plant species. They eat some animals, including small things like insects, ants, and termites, but it's certainly the meat in their diet only accounts for about 2% of their diet, so it's a very small amount, but the protein is important for them.
The interesting thing about chimpanzees is they spend most of their lives knuckle walking across the forest floor for miles every day. And then when they find a fruit tree, they climb the tree and they feed on the fruit. And fruit is about 3/4 of their diet in most forests.
Finding food is a big part of what any wild animal does. So they spend probably 40 to 60% of their day finding food and processing food and eating. But that includes traveling from one area to another, and they have to actually remember all the different fruiting trees, where they may be located, and what time of the year they would be fruiting.
So a chimpanzee might travel 5 or 6 or 7 miles in one day from tree to tree to tree on the ground looking for sources of ripe fruit, and then climb the trees when they find ripe fruit.
These are tube treats, and they have peanut butter on the inside with cereal stuck to it, and just old paper towel tubes and toilet paper tubes. So we throw them down and they love peanut butter.
The chimpanzee adult is about as intelligent as a 2-year-old child. For instance, we know that chimpanzees can count. We know they have a very exact sense of numbers. In fact, some of the laboratory studies have shown that chimps can sequence numbers, if they can recognize the English numerals 1 through 10 and put them into a proper sequence.
There's this wonderful set of studies working with chimpanzees, and the chimps are first asked to look at an array of numbers and to place them in order. And then you get to what is really, to me, the ultimate aspect of this study, where you start decreasing how long the initial number array is visible.
So you see them and they disappear right away. And then you still have to touch the spots where the numbers were in the right order.
The numbers flash so fast, I can't even begin to tell you what numbers are where. And this is something humans cannot do. We just can't perceive things as quickly as these chimps are doing it.
And even though we have a brain that is 3 times bigger than a chimp brain, and automatically it's a more powerful brain, so we can do more with it and we're smarter than a chimp. And then the question becomes, is it fundamentally different or not? And the only area where I think we really differ is in language. But in almost everything else, things related to memory or thinking or fairness or in all these areas, we're very similar, I think.
One of the most fascinating things about great apes is that they are technological creatures. And when Jane Goodall first reported tool use and tool making by chimpanzees in 1961, it was a stunning revelation. It changed our view of animals, it changed our view of ourselves as a human animal. And of the 4 great apes, chimpanzees are by far the most technological. They make a wide variety of tools, dozens of different styles of manufacture. They make stick tools that they fashion from twigs, that they use to probe into termite mounds to get termites from. And so chimpanzees are very highly technological.
Chimpanzees are very, very well known as excellent tool users, and they use tools in many different ways. A lot of the tool use is in getting food. They may use big stones to crack nuts that are too hard for them to crack, say, with their teeth. And they use leaves to put into a hollow in a log to sponge out some of the water to get something to drink. So, I mean, the tool use that they have is very advanced. They think about it well in advance. A lot of times they have to actually get what the tool might be and carry it a long way and plan for use later in the day as well.
Unfortunately, in the United States, one of the things that we found through research that's been done is that people do not know that chimpanzees are in danger.
Well, chimpanzees are an endangered species, and there's only about 150,000 left in Africa now.
And this is the time that I think that there are going to be changes with how people see chimpanzees and how chimpanzees are treated, both in the wild and in captivity.
Interesting thing about gorillas is that up until recently they were actually considered a single species and they were considered to be three subspecies. Now we have them split into two species with four subspecies. So there's four different types of gorillas. So basically they're divided based on where they are in Africa. So there are the western gorillas, and those have two subspecies. One is the western lowland gorilla, and that's the type of gorilla that you see if you go to a zoo. And then there's the cross river gorilla, which is not very much is known about at all. There's only about 300 of them left on the planet. And then in eastern Africa, or sort of central Africa, there's the eastern gorilla. And the two types there are the Grauer's gorilla, which only is found in Eastern Democratic Republic of Congo, and then the mountain gorilla, which was made famous by Dian Fossey in the movie Gorillas in the Mist. What always amazes me when I think about Dian Fossey going to study gorillas in 1967, so here's a woman that goes off to Africa by herself to study gorillas, and when you think about the perception of gorillas at that time, it was very much King Kong, these huge, aggressive, mean animals. And one of the things that I think was so pioneering about her work was that she got to know about gorilla social life, the same way that Jane Goodall got to know about chimp social life. And what she taught us was actually that image is completely incorrect. And the nickname that we give to gorillas is actually gentle giants. Now, obviously, they can be aggressive if they need to defend themselves or their families. But overall, a gorilla group in an average day, you see very little fighting. Part of it is their diet. They have food available everywhere, so they don't really need to fight over food the way that you might see in some other types of species that have more defendable food that they want to get at and fight.
Gorillas are, of course, the largest primate on Earth, and they're possibly the largest primate that's ever lived. They have a few competitors on the fossil record for that title, but a male gorilla, 400 to 450 pounds, and a female gorilla might be on the order of 250 pounds. And they've often been called, kind of sarcastically, the cows of the primate world because they're big. They spend a lot of time eating green vegetables, and as far as we know, essentially completely vegan. They sometimes have been seen to have the opportunity to eat, say, an injured baby antelope on the trail in front of them, and they ignore it.
Gorillas are the most vegetarian of all the apes. Western gorillas tend to eat a lot of fruit, and fruit tends to be really widely distributed, and so they actually have to travel quite a distance, maybe to go from one fruiting tree to another. So they tend to range over larger areas. Mountain gorillas, on the other hand, they basically live in a big salad bowl. They have food almost everywhere around them, and so their travel distance can be very short because they can basically move very quickly from one food patch to another. But for the most part, they spend a lot of their day eating. A male gorilla can eat up to 50, 60 pounds of food a day to be able to keep that big size on him. So So a lot of their day is spent eating, and then a lot of their day is spent resting and digesting their food. The average gorilla group is usually about 10 individuals, and it's usually comprised of a single dominant male that we call a silverback. Every male gorilla becomes a silverback. It's a process of maturation, the same way that humans mature and their male shoulders get big and they get facial hair. When gorilla males mature, they get a silver crest on their back. And so there's usually one male, multiple females, and then their offspring.
The silverback will live with a group of females, but he's not really in control of them. He may try to be, but actually females kind of drive the gorilla mating system by migrating between groups.
Females are the moving unit. So females transfer between groups. And so a lot of times we think that there's something about the male that they find attractive, whether it be his size or how well he displays. And so a female will move from one group to another. And it's the silverback's job to protect them and help them get integrated. Because obviously he benefits by having a new female in the group because now he has a new potential breeding partner. One of the things that always makes me laugh about gorillas is they're very stoic and they have these very, very straight faces. And they don't communicate a lot with facial gestures. So they communicate a lot by sound. And so what you'll hear if you're in a gorilla group is kind of this constant communication. And then the males have these very impressive displays that they'll do when they're showing off to a female or to another male, and they'll beat their chest, which is, you know, something I think most people are familiar with gorillas. But they have air sacs that are located underneath their chest, and so it makes a very resonating popping sound that can actually carry quite a distance. Learning the lifespan of something like a gorilla or an ape, because they live for such a long time, is really difficult. The Dian Fossey Gorilla Fund has been studying gorillas in Africa since 1967, and we are just now starting to get an idea of their lifespan. So we're just now getting to the point where we've seen gorillas born, and then that same gorilla live to pretty much what we would consider very old age. So the oldest male gorilla that we know of in the wild lived to be 35 years of age, and the oldest female is in their early 40s. And what's very interesting is in captivity, we see that gorillas can live quite a bit longer. So here at Zoo Atlanta, we actually have a male gorilla that's 50 years old, and we have a female that's 52. So captivity seems to add potentially up to a decade onto their lifespan, or even 15 years as compared to the wild. And it's probably because they have access to really good, high quality food all the time. They have veterinary care, so if they have injuries or get ill, they have vets that take care of them. They're protected, they have people with them basically every single day, going through the forest, removing snares, getting rid of poachers, things like that. We do know for Cross River gorillas that there only are about 300 left, so they are considered the most endangered subspecies of any ape. For Western gorillas, we think there are probably about 100 to 120,000 of them left, and that number sounds really robust, but there are grave concerns about their long-term survival because of hunting and then also because of disease. For the Eastern gorillas, we think that they could be down around 5,000 individuals, and for the mountain gorillas, we actually know that there are 780 of those. And they are on the increase, which is really an amazing story. We know of no other ape population that's increasing in numbers. So we're very excited. And one of the things I tell people is just learn more about animals. It always amazes me that people don't know that gorillas are endangered, that the estimates are that gorillas and other great apes could be gone from the planet in the next few decades if we don't reverse their declines. So learn more about them. Tell your friends. Educate people so that they know, because there's always something new to learn.
Thank you.
Orangutans are an unusual type of great ape. They have some interesting distinctions. They're the only Asian great ape. All of the other great apes, gorillas, bonobos, and chimpanzees, are found in Africa. So orangutans are limited today to Southeast Asia on the islands of Borneo and Sumatra. And they're also distinctive because they're the only great ape that spends the majority of their lives in the trees. The majority of their big muscle groups are from the waist up. They're also red, have big beards, a big throat sac, and probably the most distinctive thing for males are the big cheek pads, which the females don't have any of that. And on top of that, they have a very unusual social structure. They spend a lot of their adult years alone, particularly so for adult males.
They're largely solitary. Their basic unit of society is a mom and whatever baby she's currently raising. And the male is out there somewhere but not living with her. And this has always been hard for us to understand why an animal that has such a big brain should be socially complicated, seems not to be. And we believe these days that it has to do with food supply. Orangutans are very, very keyed into their supply of fruit in the forest. Females come into cycling and ovulate in absolute synchronicity with the available food in the forest. But in general, they are less known than the other great apes simply because they live alone. So if you're going to spend your PhD thesis of 2 years in the forest studying orangutans, you spend a lot of time looking at one animal. Whereas I can go out and sit among 50 chimpanzees or 20 gorillas and learn about something from each one every minute of the day. Orangutans are omnivores, but the amount of meat on their diet is very, very small. They've been occasionally known to eat a squirrel here, a lizard there, but primarily they're eating fruits. They like ripe fruits. They're great forest rangers. They know the forest extremely well.
Their most preferred item is fruit. But that's not always available in the forest. So they have a number of other foods that they can eat as well. They can go for figs. That's a good solid fruit, probably not the most preferred, but it's a good one. When those are not available, they'll eat a huge number of different plants and plant parts. And if that is not available, they fall back to eating things like bark or scraping the inside of bark that they pull off a tree. But when food is very plentiful and there's plenty for everyone to eat, orangutans can be quite sociable with each other. So it really is a question of flexibility on their part. They are not locked into one particular way of behaving. The interesting thing, and I think that the glue that holds orangutan society together in the wild, is that females are the ones that are choosing to mate with specific males. And since they're not traveling with those males or living with those males full time, they have to find them in the forest. And part of that is listening for the vocalizations that full adult males make, this great call. And females can go to that adult male and then invite him to potentially reproduce. But that interval when a male and a female might spend some time together can be very short. It can be hours or just a couple days, and then that's it. They don't spend any more time together for a very long period. So it's very unusual among great apes, but works very, very well for orangutans. As far as we know, we experience the world through our senses in the same way that orangutans do. We have the same vision, same hearing, relatively similar sense of smell, and we know with certainty that orangutans are at least equivalent to all the other great apes in terms of mental skill. And a great example is tool use. We know that orangutans in the wild and in captivity are extraordinarily good tool users. Also, we know that they are capable of learning human language, such as sign language or written symbols. But the big question is, how do they relate then to human mental abilities? This video documents a typical research session that I'd be conducting with AZ. He would come up and sit in front of a large touch-sensitive computer screen, and he's basically doing a vocabulary review. I'm asking him to look at a variety of objects, and he's choosing the symbol name that he's learned. And he's learned to recognize and identify that symbol, and he touches it, and then he uses a send key to let me know he's finished and he's made his selection. And importantly, what it shows is that he's learned the symbol for the symbol. He hasn't just learned and memorized individual questions outside of understanding the symbol. He can also understand how to use photographs and drawings. So importantly, he's matching a concept. And the other thing that we've worked on quite a lot is his ability to understand numbers. This is a much harder concept than learning how to identify an item, because you're really naming an idea. But these are all things that orangutans can do. So stated simply, we know they're really smart. The situation with orangutans in terms of their conservation is a very serious one. Populations are declining annually. In Sumatra, there's somewhere between 6,500 and 7,000 orangutans estimated to remain. That's it for the whole population of Sumatran orangutans, which is a distinct species. On Borneo, it's a slightly different story. There are a larger number of orangutans, maybe around 35,000 or a few more, but those numbers are a little deceiving. Habitat destruction continues, and some poaching is all incredibly damaging to existing populations. And what goes along with that is an important part of orangutan biology. Orangutan females have the slowest birth rate of any mammal on land. So females only have a baby every 7 to 9 years, and it's simply just not sustainable. So this fact of their biology combined with human pressures is creating a genuine conservation crisis.